Okay, recording is started. Okay, so next topic which we are going to discuss is chronemics. Chronemics coming from the literal word chronology. Now, chronology means in order of what?
Sir, in order of events. With respect to time.
In order of events with respect to time. So how you use time generally comes under the chronemics. What does the time conveys? Because in the modern world, in professional communication, you can see time conveys several meanings. So definitely, if you are talking about the professional world, time can convey several meaning and has certain meaning dependent upon the situation. Okay, time factor is precise, time factor is valuable to everyone, it is important to everyone, especially the professional people who are busy all the time or most of the time. So how you convey the message through the time, that is also very important. Either you can give someone time, either you can save time, waste time, or you can take some people's time. So how the time will convey the message, that is determined in the chronemics. Okay. Like for instance, if you call somebody at late at night, what does it conveys? Like say after the odd hours, after 12.
At night. Something like emergency.
Emergency. Emergency, very important message, urgency of the message, those things can be conveyed. Or if you are calling too early, then also emergency. Then late arrival or punctuality, those things also convey certain message. They say about how you organized you are or how you work, those things, the punctuality. And if you are late, it shows some kind of tardiness, which is considered as an insult in some of the or most of the organization. In some situations, even late coming is allowed as a fashion sense, which is called as fashionably late. You must have heard about the same. Dependent upon the culture, dependent upon the situation, time also conveys several messages. So what does that thing, fashionably late, conveys? Or when is it acceptable?
Sir, when she is a heroine.
Only she? Why to be gender specific?
Sorry.
Anyone who can be a celebrity or very important person, they can be fashionably late to events which are not of professional importance. Casual events especially.
When someone is backbencher.
Maybe that shows, what kind of thing it shows, what kind of message it conveys. A celebrity being fashionably late to a casual event. What does it convey about that particular celebrity?
He was busy.
Like he is very rare, sir. Rare, I mean.
Yes. His time is
to
very
increase
precious.
His famous.
Yes, maybe. It can be taken into positive sense, it can be taken into negative sense, but generally if it is from the point of view of the celebrity himself, being deliberately fashionably late is a kind of style statement. May not be taken into the right things in the where punctuality is important. So every time you use the time, it can be either saved, wasted, given or taken, and in that way it conveys certain message. In professional world especially, you have to be punctual, and if you are using the ungodly hours, then that message should be at least very much important. It shows the urgency of the message or something which is to be attended on priority basis. This is chronemics. Then comes I hope it is clear. Chronemics.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So next comes paralanguage. Paralanguage is about the vocal cues related to voice, related to tone, related to pitch, all the voice related things. It is segregated into four parts: the voice qualities, the voice or vocal characterizers, the vocal qualifiers, and vocal segregate. Okay. Now, what are they? Let us discuss. Before that, can you tell me any example where voice plays an important role to convey a certain message? There are a number of examples. Give me
one. If we speak louder, it shows that we are angry.
Okay, it shows that you are angry. What else it may show?
Someone is far away from us.
Distance, it may show some kind of distance. It may give the idea of a distance. Okay. What else?
We speak slowly or in a low pitch, then it shows that we are sad.
Okay. Okay. Anything else? Where voice can be used as a method to convey some message?
Yes, sir. Like someone in danger, and if they call someone, they would say some one side fearing and another side giving hint. Yes.
Okay. So again, that is dependent upon the situation also, because all the non-verbal cues, mostly they are dependent upon particular situation. Otherwise, they have several meanings. One cue having several meanings. So they are dependent upon situation, but voice also gives a certain kind of message. So sounds are the basis of paralanguage. Vocal cues are the basis of paralanguage. Now first come to the voice qualities. Voice qualities is the very basic thing, that is the physical voice, the physical sound itself. So it will include factors such as the pitch, the resonance in the voice, the volume, the rate of words which you speak within a minute or two, and the rhythm which you are using. So all the physical characteristics of the sound which you are making through your throat, that is under the voice qualities. Those factors comes under the voice qualities. Next is voice character or vocal characterizers. Vocal characterizers are the characterizers or the characteristic things which you do to your voice, like ringing of the laughter, coughing like this, or throat clearing, then sighing, this making of a sound of passing of air, that is sighing. These all give certain kind of meaning. Throat clearing may be some kind of pointing out of a certain point, or coughing is like maybe some kind of disagreement with what somebody is speaking. Sighing may be giving up or being tired. Laughter, your happiness. So every kind of vocal characterizers, they give in meaning to the voice qualities. Then comes the vocal qualifiers. Vocal qualifiers and qualities are almost similar. Qualities are the physical things, the pitch, tone, volume, rhythm, etc. Vocal qualifiers are how you make the variations within all those voice qualities, like the pitch, resonance, volume, rate, rhythm, etc. So all the variations within the pitch, the volume, comes under the voice or vocal qualifiers. How they are important? The vocal qualifiers. Why they are segregated from the voice qualities? Yes, anyone?
So to avoid being monotonic.
Yes, to avoid being monotonic, or to avoid being having a consistent tone which leads to certain kind of misunderstanding. So in that way, the vocal qualifiers can be segregated from voice qualities, and it refers to the variations. Like if I want to say something which is very important, I will raise my voice a bit. Is it so? While speaking consistently, because consistent voice tone is generally preferable in most of the situation. However, to speak something of utmost importance or to point out certain special points or special paragraphs within my speech, I can make the variations within the voice qualities so that the message is more clear. To make it more understandable, to make the message more understandable, to make the content more understandable, vocal qualifiers are generally used. So it refers to variations in the voice qualities, that is especially the pitch and the volume. Then vocal segregates. Vocal segregates are definitely the pauses, because we are using the term segregates, which makes, what do you mean by segregates? In literal sense, as a layman term. What do you mean by segregates? Generally?
So it is about separation.
Separation. So when we separate two sentences, or when we separate various parts of our speech, then we take certain pauses. So those pauses are generally referred to as the vocal segregates. Now these pauses can be either silent or with sounds such as ahs, ahs, or ums. Those are certain kind of pauses which most of the people use either knowingly or unknowingly. So these also give in certain kind of meaning to the message. It shows your thinking process. It shows some kind of like breakage in the sentence, like I am using this in between. So most of the people, they use pauses, and with pauses, one thing you should note, that most of the time you should take silent pause, but it is not possible because automatically your conscious mind makes in some kind of signal or sends in some kind of signal to your mouth to send in some messages or some in between messages, which forms as the vocal segregates. Vocal segregates are also very necessary within speech, because that will continue or lead you to continue your speech consistently over a period of time. So that is why vocal segregates are very important. So these are the four things in the paralanguage, coming from voice qualities, that is the physical sound itself, consisting of the pitch, resonance, volume, rate, and rhythm. And then comes the vocal characterizers, which are the things or characteristics which you give through your movement of some kind of volume, like the throat clearing or something, or using various body parts when you make in the characteristics within the voice, that is vocal characterizers. Then vocal qualifiers are the variations within the voice qualities, and vocal segregates are the pauses. Intermittent pauses in between the your speech, in between your sentences. It can be silent pauses also. So understood? Paralanguage? What is paralanguage? Yes or no?
Yeah.
Okay. Now if you have understood well, then one by one tell me about each. First, the voice qualities. What is voice qualities? Anyone?
The type of voices we make.
Okay, which includes?
Includes like clearing throats.
I'm asking about voice qualities. Clearing throat comes under vocal characterizers.
Pitch, rhythm,
Yes, that pitch, rhythm, resonance, volume, etc. The physical qualities. That is why the name is voice qualities. Then what comes under vocal characterizes? Yes. It can be answered by anyone. Not only the single person who is answering should answer again. Anyone can answer. What is vocal characterizes?
Copying, quoting, or sign language.
What? Abhishek, can you repeat?
So, like copying, quoting,
okay.
and we can say like science language.
Not sign language, sign. I'm using the word sign. S-I-G-H-I-N.
Yes, sign. Deep breathe.
Yes, deep breathing. Yes, sir. Okay. So, how does this work? This vocal characterizes? In the total volume or voice we are producing, how does this vocal characterizes work? What do they do? Yes.
So, like each of these convey different meanings. Like cuffing could mean a non-worded disapproval.
Okay.
Sighing could mean boredom, or throat clearing could actually be done before emphasizing a certain point. So.
Right. Good. So in this way, you will explain, because knowing the thing is not enough. How you are going to explain it, that is more important in communication, because communication is more about clear understanding. So clarity should be given through examples, through putting in more words to what you are saying. So especially in the examination, it is expected of you to explain the things clearly. Okay. Next is vocal qualifiers. What are vocal qualifiers?
Sir, to remove monotonicity, we use vocal qualifiers like increasing the pitch, changing it.
Okay. As well as the volume also. Not only the pitch, but volume. Also the volume also. So volume, both rhythm, the pitch and the volume or rhythm or anything, those voice qualities can be variated with the different scenarios, with the different parts of the speech, so that the monotonicity can be removed, as well as it provides certain kind of message that this point is or this part is important. Whenever you see that somebody is speaking, whenever he is speaking some important, significant part, the voice you will see definitely goes up, or the tone or the volume goes up. That generally happens. Otherwise, it remains on the consistent note. Then vocal segregates, what are they?
They're like pauses in the speech.
Pauses in the speech. Okay. What does this? Yes, continue.
Sir, it could mean that when he or she is giving a speech, if he or she is disorganized in his speech, then they can take pauses.
Okay. Or, so that is the interval, acceptable intervals.
Yes, sir. Right? Or when they are shy or entering the stage for the very first time, they could feel shy and take pauses.
So these also influence the meaning in a way that it is a consistent speech, and the definite pause can be taken after each interval. Even if you have seen good speakers to speak something, they will take some interval in between and either sip a glass of water or something, or make in certain pauses in between. Most of the actors, even you may have seen in the interviews, they take in several pauses in between the hours and ums, like they are thinking something or they are actually showing that they are thinking something. So those kind of messages can be conveyed through pauses or vocal certificates. So these are the four types of thing which comes under the paralanguage. Now let's come to the, is it clear? The paralanguage is clear before we move further?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next we come to kinesics. Kinesics comes from the word kinetic, which means, you are science people, you must know what is kinetics.
Motion.
So in this context, like in the context of non-verbal communication, it is the motion of the body or the body movements. So how does the body movements affects or given the meaning that we'll study under the kinesics. So now let's first see that what does the kinesics do. Directly after that, we'll move on to what are the various parts of the kinesics, like facial expression, gestures, postures, etc. But before that, let us see what does the kinesics do, or what are the things which the kinesics convey. So first, it is used as emblems. Emblems like which have direct verbal translation, like gestures which we use to signify either okay or peace or victory. Some kind of finger movement is there, some kind of gesture is there, definite gesture is there. So definitely it is a sign. So those signs are the emblems. Another part of the kinesics is another way in which we use the kinesics is as illustrators. The movements or the body movements which serve to illustrate the meaning of the words which we use along with the words. Like if I say sit there in the class without showing you by the hand movement where to sit, will there be confusion?
Yes,
sir. Obviously there will be confusion. So when I use sit there to illustrate, I generally show you the hand movement or point out towards a particular seat and then I say sit there. Then that will be the illustrator. So accompanying the words, we use certain kind of non-verbal cues to give in the meaning. So it can be used as illustrators. Then effect displays. Effect displays means it can also be used as an indicator of inner emotions. So any kind of body movement which shows your inner emotion, can you tell me about? Anything. There are many ways in which you can affect displays, affect or show your inner emotions. So what kind of body movement or gesture?
So like thinking and depression.
Like
thinking and depression.
So what kind of body gesture to be used in that situation?
Like a silent gesture.
Silent gesture, okay. Or if I say that a clenched fist. A clenched fist may show what kind of emotion?
Anger.
Or some kind of hostility. Then if I say a bowed head,
thinking or depression.
Head.
Yes, right. Then a stooped posture. A stooped posture where your shoulders are stooped down.
Mm-hmm.
Tired.
Maybe tired or maybe submissive. Can be dominated by others. Because the person who is confident enough, you may have generally heard that to sit straight in the class, that shows some kind of discipline and confidence, as well as the vigilance, that you are attentively listening to what somebody is saying. Instead, if you get a stoop posture, that is submissiveness and accepting dominance and tiredness and non-attentiveness, those things can be conveyed.
Sir?
Yes?
Sir, can biting of nails be also a display showing?
Yes, yes, things? Nervousness.
Yes. Okay, sir.
Definitely, these are effective skills. So, then next is regulators. Regulators which control the flow of conversation between individuals. Regulators like you have gone through GD in the lab, in the English labs?
Yes, sir.
So you, because you have not done it physically, so I cannot exactly say that you have gone through this or not. But generally, when you give the other people the chance to speak, you show your hands to that people or not towards that people. That is a way of regulating the conversation. To maintain the flow of the conversation, to regulate the conversation, you generally make in certain kind of gesture. Or if you want someone to speak faster, what kind of hand gesture is generally made without speaking? You can move your hand in front of your mouth and shake your hand so that the other person can know that you want him to go faster. Or if you want to slow down, you can tap your hand up and down. That shows to slow down. To repeat again, you can move your hand forward and backward. Those things are there which regulates certain kind of conversation. So either if you want an individual to slow down, to speak faster, to repeat, to elaborate, every time you can control the flow of conversation with your nonverbal gestures. So it can also act as regulators. And one more thing is adapters. Adaptation to certain environment. Like in a class when people foot wiggle, what does that convey? Wiggling of the foot.
Nervousness.
Nervousness or bored individuals?
What, sir? What these individuals?
Bored. For people who are completely bored because of a lethargic topic or something. So that kind of foot wiggling is very automatic, those people. Because when your mind is totally blank and you are bored, automatically some or other limb of your body will try to compensate that absence of the behavior. So foot wiggling, these are all scientific things, the psychological things which happens automatically. The speaker can get a message, can get an idea that you are either bored or you are either nervous because of a certain topic. So this conveys message. So behavior through which the people adapt to their environment are called as adapters, and these adapters can also be shown through the kinesthetics. So these are the five ways in which the kinesthetics can be used: the emblems, illustrators, effect displays, regulators, and adapters. Now let us come to the description or detailed discussion of all the kinesics or the parts,
sir,
of kinesics. Yes.
Can you please explain the first one again?
The emblems?
Yes, sir.
So what is the literal meaning of emblem? Can you tell me?
I don't know, sir.
It means symbols. So you have, we have studied about the sign language.
Yes, sir.
So similar is the case with the gestures. You can use the gestures as some kind of symbol, some kind of sign language. Like yes, if you want to speak about peace or victory, you have a definite like V-shaped of the fingers, V-shaped fingers. So those are emblems, some kind of symbols to convey certain definite message. But they have definite message. That must be very much clear about the emblems. Emblems are the definite or certain symbols which show certain kind of meaning. Like we used to signify for okay, peace or victory. There are gestures, definite gestures. Most of the time, okay, peace and victory have similar, same kind of V gesture, but peace may have certain other kind of gestures also. Okay. So these five things clear about kinesics? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let's move on
yes,
to
sir.
The parts of the kinesics. That is what is actually there within the kinesics, through which movements we can show or which body movement we can give in certain or convey certain meaning. So those are the first thing is facial expressions. How you use your parts of the face to express something. Your face is generally divided into three parts, the upper face, the middle face and the lower face. And how you use that to describe certain message or given certain message, that comes under facial expression. Then there are, just give me 1 minute. So next is gestures. Gestures are all kinds of hand, head, body movement. Any kind of hand, head, body movement that comes under gestures. Posture is something different from gesture. Can you explain what is the difference between postures and gestures? If you are able to explain it properly, then okay, otherwise I'll explain it. What are postures? How it is different from gestures? Yes?
So posture means the way we stand and the way we sit and walk and all. And gestures means the hand movements like shaking of legs and etc. Okay. Which indicates something.
Any kind of body movement that means comes under the gestures, and any kind of way in which you hold your body that comes under the posture. Movement, gesture, holding, posture. Understood?
Yes, sir.
So posture is definitely what you said. Very right. It is the way how you sit, you stand, you walk, you lie, everything. So every time you can see that it is holding of the body, holding of a certain position. So with position comes the word posture. And gestures come from the word of movement, gestations, the body movement. Okay. Now, when we come to gesture and posture, we will study it in detail, because again, in posture, there are dynamic posture, there are static postures and all those things. So we'll discuss those things later. Then comes the eye contact. Eye contact is also very important, or plays a very important role in the overall communication as a nonverbal cue. What are the things which you can convey through your eyes? Can you tell me? only your eye movement and not talking about any other body part.
Anger, agreement.
Anger, agreement. What else?
Surprisedness.
Surprised. Okay.
Sorry, arrogance.
Arrogance. Can you show acceptance?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. Basically, the eye contact is the movement of the eyelids, or widening or shortening of the eyes, narrowing of the eyes. Narrowing down the eyes generally, either you are confused or you are showing some kind of curiosity towards a certain thing. Those things can be there in the eye contact. And then ultimately the tactile or the touch. How you touch, sir, the other person, that, yes.
Sir, how to show acceptance with eyes?
How to show acceptance with eyes? You generally flap your eyelids more. You show a certain kind of, with your gesture of moving your head, you generally flap your eyes more. That kind of eye contact is generally showing some kind of acceptance towards a certain topic.
But your movement of the head is also coming.
Yes, so it will be used in combination.
Then
some parts of the kinesics will be there which cannot be used singularly. It will be used in combinations. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So that you have to keep in mind, and that is very obvious also, because to show the ultimate meaning of every message, there can be hundreds of gestures and posture which can be used simultaneously along with one another. It is not something which is happening in an isolated environment, like one thing happening, another thing not happening. Right?
Yes, sir.
Then tactile and touch, the last thing. Tactile or touch, why to touch also you can show in certain or give in certain kind of meaning. There is soft touch, there is hard touch, there is good touch, bad touch, or there is some friendly touch. Everything is there within the touch also. It can show some kind of happiness, some kind of anger. Everything can be very much clear through the touch. Now, touch can be with a verbal cue, with a non-verbal cue, or by the touch itself. So in a combination of another non-verbal cue, or in a combination with word, or only the touch can also convey certain kind of message. So it can be used in three forms. So for the theoretical purposes, we are describing all these into various segregates. We are going into so much of details of each and every part. But in general, what happens is we have to keep in mind that which gesture, postures, etc. are acceptable and which gives in certain kind of meaning. And by keeping it all these in mind, we have to normally perform, normally communicate with the other people. The only thing is that you have to know the meaning of all these things, so that you can use it appropriately. So let's come to the first part, that is facial expressions. Can you see the slide of facial expressions?
Yes, sir.
So you can see the pictures also. So simple smile, frown, etc. can tell a lot of stories or a lot of things about a certain person. One is happy, sad, surprised, angry, everything is evident. By the type of the smile one is giving, by the type of the facial expression one is making. Because facial expression again is a combination of all the three parts of your face, the upper face, which consists of the eyebrows and the forehead. Then the middle face, which consists of the eyes, the eyelids, and the nose foot, and the lower face, which is generally the mouth and the chin. Sometimes one more type of or more part of face is taken into consideration, that is the sides of the face like your cheeks, sucking in the air or blowing it out also gives in certain kind of meaning. So cheeks are also divided into one part of the face. So basically three parts, upper, middle, lower, and then the side face. Now, what kind of things these facial expressions shows can be given by, if the forehead, that is the upper face, is moving upward and downward, what does it shows? Or it is showing some kind of wrinkles, the forehead. What kind of thing is it showing?
Worry.
Worry, frowning, right? Then if I say the eyelids are opening and closing narrowly, yes, what does it speak? Every facial expression speaks volumes.
Respecting someone.
Okay. Okay. Then wide open eyes and slightly open mouth.
Surprise.
Surprise, right. Then eyebrows raised and drawn together. What? Which kind of emotion?
Anger.
Eyebrows raised and drawn together.
Asking something.
Okay. Okay. Drops of perspiration on your face, especially your forehead. Yes.
Nervous or anxious.
Okay, nervous or anxious or fear also sometimes. Then reddening of the cheek, that is the fourth part of the face, which you called as blushing. What kind of emotion does it show?
So punishment.
Punishment.
Embarrassment.
Maybe embarrassment. Maybe some kind of happy feeling also. Then wrinkled nose.
So does it show punishment?
Redness of the cheeks.
Yes, sir. Whenever you got hit by someone slaps you.
Okay, like it is physically you are talking about.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Obviously, that is the physical, that is exactly, we cannot call it as non-verbal thing. That is an impact of the physical thing which has been done.
But
not something so, which you are doing because of a certain kind of expressing yourself. It is automatic. Your skin has, your cells have died, and that is why that reddening. That does not come under the expression. You are not expressing it.
So, okay.
Okay. So, how will you show frustration? What kind of facial expressions will be there? Like any kind of movement in the eyebrow or nose or something. What kind of thing will be there in the case of frustration?
Sir, probably scrunched eyebrows or clenched teeth or any.
Okay, right. Mostly the upper lips, they are in work in the case of frustrations.
The narrowing of the lips.
Narrowing of the lips, right. You can see the face in the case of anger, the fourth face in the slide. And you can see the facial expression. So that is generally for anger, frustration, etc. Sadness, the lower lip working. You can see the third photo from the first order. If we, this is the first one, then second, third, and fourth. Fourth one is anger. This one is sadness. This one is surprised or happy. And happy is this one. This one is more surprised. So these are the facial expressions. Then let's move. I guess it is clear about the facial expression, how you will explain it. Within the facial expression, you have to explain firstly what is facial expression and how you communicate, what are the four parts of the human face. That is the three main parts and one extra part, the upper face, middle face and lower face, and then the sides of the faces of the face, that is the cheeks, and then how those things could be used to convey various kinds of meaning, like sadness, mainly the four meaning, the happiness, sadness, surprised or angry kind of expression. Others are just an extension over all these kind of feeling. Then let's move on to the next part, that is gestures, if you don't have any kind of doubt in the case of facial expressions. So facial expressions, any doubt?
No, sir.
Okay. Then let's come to gestures. Gestures is a movement of the head, hand, body, etc. And it is done to express a certain kind of ideas or certain kind of feelings or certain kind of emotions, anything. Actions, when these are given through the gestures of how a person is feeling, that can be through any kind of body movement, either your legs, hands, anything can move. And those will give or provide certain kind of gesture which provide meaningful message which accompany the spoken words, or either they can stand alone also. If they are used as emblems, they will be standing alone. If they are used as illustrators, they will be using words. So those things can be there. Then there is sign language for the deaf people, where gestures are, have a specific importance. So now I'll ask you about a few gestures which are commonly used. You may be knowing about those things. So what is the meaning of those gestures? Just tell me. Folded arms, which generally you all sit mostly in the classrooms and interviews, folded arms. What does that show?
Confident.
Yes. First tell me, is it acceptable, especially in the case of interviews or not, to sit with folded arms?
No, sir, it is not acceptable.
Not acceptable, okay. And why? Why it is so? Yes, you are right, but why?
Sir, it kind of shows some sort of an aloofness. Attitude or arrogance. Yes.
Attitude, arrogance. Moreover, it does not show your open-mindedness. It shows your conservativeness. You are not open to new ideas. So that is why folded arms are not acceptable kind of gestures, especially in the case of formal interpersonal communications like interviews. Then, wink of the eyes, what does that show? Yes.
Sir, it is like some signal to kind of joke. Okay. Joking someone.
Some kind of sarcasm, some kind of humor, etc. Wink of the eyes. Then mouth guard. You put your hands over your mouth.
Shock.
Shock. Surprise, etc. Then thumb and finger rub. or both the hands rubbing against each other.
Sir, very tenseful situation.
Tenseful situation or impatience? Okay. Then running your hands through your hair.
Sir, lack of attentiveness.
Lack of attentiveness. Okay. Any exact, more exact kind of meaning? When you
so
run
can
your
it
hands.
Be confusion?
Yes, it is. It is. Then both hand placed upon the chest. Both hands together and pressed upon the chest.
Sir, is it obeying or praying?
Obeying or praying, right? Or some kind of acceptance, acceptable behavior, especially in the emotional situations. Then jiggling of the leg, I already told you. Yes, yes.
What sometimes it can show change in our opinion.
Change in our opinion by holding both the hands towards our chest.
Yes, sir. Like empires do that to review their decision.
Okay. So that is specific to a particular game. If you are talking generally, then
all those you have said previously, those come.
Then one more thing is there when going for interview. Is it acceptable to put your hands in your pockets and then continue speaking?
No, sir.
And why is it so? Why is it not acceptable? What thing does it show?
Sorry, does it show superior nature?
It shows some kind of dominance, right? You can say it, it shows some kind of superior nature. Like you are totally rejecting the ideas, or there is complete resistance to the change or new ideas given by the others, or you are a bit dominant. Show some kind of dominance. So again, so what is acceptable then? When you are sitting in an interview, what kind of gesture is acceptable? Where to put your hands then? And in what kind of gestures should be made? Generally, the hands
sir,
should
we
be
can
on your...
show our palms.
Yes, yes, yes. What are you saying?
So, like, we can try that. We can show our palm to them whenever we used to say something.
You can show your palms to them, like keeping
yes,
it
sir,
on the table.
No, sorry, near or in front of us, sir. Like, not
like
folding
if you are sitting
and
in an
not
interview things. Where the panel of judges are there. And you are sitting in front of them, and in between you and the judges, there is a table, and you are sitting in a chair. So then, where to put the hands?
Sir, at our laps.
On the table.
I mean,
on the laps. On the laps. Either you can normally casually put them, or you can put one over the other. That will be sufficient. Do not sit in like arms folded. Neither do you put the arms in your pockets, or you are sitting too much leaning towards the interviewer. So those things should be there. A normal gesture, normal calm gesture that you are open to new ideas, you will accept new things, you will respond coolly, and you are confident enough to assert yourself. That those things will be clear with your normal gestures. So most of the time, a relaxed gesture is more suitable. One of the important things which I wanted to discuss in the gestures, it is also there in the slides, this is the handshakes. Handshakes play a very important role in the gestures part and in professional world. That we'll discuss in the next class. Because time is over for today. Let's stop here.